Hey, good morning, Mountain West. Welcome to the best day of the week. We're so glad you're here. My name is Liz.
And my name is Joy. And if you're watching in person, online, or in one of our video venues, we just want to say welcome. And today we're continuing in our Happy Sermon series. So you picked a great Sunday to attend. Yes. And if this is your first time joining us, we want to personally welcome you to Mountain West Church. This is a place that feels like hope. And did I say that backwards? It's a place that looks like hope and feels like home. And if you're new, do us a favor. Go ahead and fill out that connection card online using that QR code. This gives us an opportunity to learn a little bit about you and also let you know about Mountain West.
Yeah, absolutely. And hey, we always have so much going on here at Mountain West, and we want you to stay connected. And one of the best ways to do that is to follow us on social media. And we're on all types of
platforms.
TikTok, YouTube, Instagram, Facebook.
Yes.
And you'll find upcoming events, sermon recaps. A lot of times we do kind of behind the scenes funny stuff.
Funny stuff, yeah.
And we also have MW students and MW kids profiles as well. So if you have kids in that age range, definitely consider following, because this is where you're going to find information about upcoming camps and what they're learning at church on a Sunday. So all around, social media is one of the best ways to stay up to date at Mountain
West.
Absolutely.
And speaking about upcoming information, let's talk about what we have coming up in Mountain West. Last Monday, we launched our Monday night gatherings, which means we will be here again tomorrow night and every Monday throughout the month of April. I think this is awesome.
Yes.
If you know someone who can't make it to church on Sunday for whatever reason, invite them to join us on Monday night at 7 p.m. We get it. So much of the world doesn't find Sunday sacred anymore. People have to work. People have family commitments. Kids have sports. Let's just be honest. It's just difficult sometimes to wake up on a Sunday to get to church. So whatever the reason is, we've got you. Our Monday night gatherings are the same as the Sunday gatherings. So whether you choose to join us early on Sunday morning, like this 8:30 service, or you can join us in the evening hours on Monday night, we are excited to see you. This is a great opportunity to invite one more, which is the entire mission here at Mountain West Church. If you know someone who has a commitment on Sunday, or people you know who would just be more receptive to a Monday night gathering, please invite them. No more barriers, no more excuses. We will see you guys on Monday nights throughout the entire month of April.
Yes, and then tonight, April 14th, is our men's night, and our theme this year is authentic manhood. So Pastor Mo is going to lead these guys in a discussion about the things that men face today in our society and the biblical definition of authentic manhood that Jesus exemplified. And so they're going to have food, worship, tons of fun. It's $15 to register, and you can do that by scanning the QR code, or you can show up tonight and pay at the door. No matter how you do it, we would love to have you join us. And remember to invite a friend to join you along the journey.
Absolutely. And next Sunday, April 21st at 6:30, we are having our young adult gathering. And so we put a definition to young adult because I literally ask every month. So young adult is between ages 18 to 30. That disqualifies you and I. But if you fall in that age range, we are inviting you to come out and hang with the MW young adults. We heard that the last young adults gathering was absolutely amazing. They played games, they had snacks, and they just spent a lot of time fellowshipping with each other. We know this upcoming gathering next week is going to be the best one yet. Our MW young adults are meeting here at the church at 6:30 p.m. for a time of worship, fellowship, and discussion. So if you're between the ages of 18 and 30, we encourage you to join us for this gathering.
Yes, and while we might not be young adults anymore, we do have families. So our Family Connect is happening on April 28th, and it'll be after all three gatherings out on our patio, like turf area. And Family Connect is for Mountain West parents with young kids to connect with one another. And so, you know, here at Mountain West, we don't want anyone doing life alone. And they have activities for the kids. They usually have some sort of snack and stuff. So they say it takes a village. So what better place to find that than at your church?
Yes, and continuing on with that village, parents, are you looking for some help this summer? And are you looking for some summer fun for your MW student? Send them to summer camp. This summer, MW students are headed to Camp Legacy. There are two options, okay? So one for the high schoolers and one for the middle schoolers. High schoolers are going to camp from June 10th through 14th. Mark that date. Middle schoolers are going from June 17th to June 21st. So we know our MW students are going to have an amazing time, make new friends, but most importantly, increase their relationship with the Lord. You can find out more information at mwchurch.com/students. Your student doesn't want to miss this, so make sure you go and sign up. It is just about time for our gathering, so let's prepare our hearts and minds.
Southern Mountain West. Come on, everybody, get on your feet. Put your hands together. Come on, let's start today right. Come on, if you got joy, sing this out.
This is the day you made. So I'll rejoice and be glad. Rejoice and be glad in it. And this is where I believe that you are more than enough for me. You are faithful to your promise. You are strong when I am weak. When I'm standing in your presence, I have everything I need.
That's how you start a Sunday morning, y'all. Good morning, Mount West. It is so good to see you guys. We got the joy of the Lord here today. It doesn't matter what you're going through. We all have joy because of God. And we're so glad you are here. Those of you guys joining online and in our video venue, welcome to church today. Turn around, find somebody, give them a high five, give them a handshake, give them a fist bump, let them know you're glad they're here today. And we're just gonna keep worshiping together.
How could I ever repay? How could I ever repay? I just want to thank you, Lord. Oh, 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 oh.
I just want to thank you, Lord.
Oh,
oh, oh.
Let's give God worship in the house. Hallelujah, Jesus. He is worthy of all praise, all honor, all glory. I don't know what you came in with, but he is still worthy of praise. I don't know what your week was like, but he is worthy of all praise. To him be the glory. To him be the honor. To him be the praise. You know, it's in moments like these that we are reminded that the Lord is a strong tower, that the righteous run in and they are saved. I don't know where you are today, but here's what I know. There is a name that is above every name, and at his name, every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess. At his name, demons begin to flee. At his name, mountains are moved. At his name, there is victory. Somebody shout out the name of Jesus. He's worthy to be praised. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. You know, Psalms 122 tells us something specific to do. I don't know if you've read the news or you've heard the reports, but Iran sent missiles towards Israel last night. But here's the good news, friend, is that the attack of the enemy did not accomplish its assignment. And here's what Psalms 122 tells us to do. To pray for the peace of Jerusalem. So would you pause with me for a moment? And can we spend a moment to pray for Israel and all of what's going on in the world today? Now, if you're a believer, you read your scriptures, you should not be alarmed about what you're seeing and what's happening, okay? This is part of the process of what the groaning pains of what will come. Here's the good news, friends. We can look up because redemption draws nigh. It may be tomorrow, it may be years from now. We don't know, but the good news is that Jesus is coming to save his church and to save his world. But we get to partner with him in prayer. So would you join me today, Father? We thank you. We bless you this morning that we have a safe place to gather and lift up your name. God, that we have a place that we can enter in and experience your power and your presence, God. And today, God, we humbly bow before you and declare that you are worthy, that you've been so good to us even when we have not been good to you. You've been faithful even when we've been faithless, God. Today we say thank you. And today, God, as humble children, we come in obedience to do what you have called us to do, to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And today, God, we lift up Israel to you, God. We lift up your nation unto you, God, and we pray for the peace of Jerusalem, God. We pray for the peace, God, in Gaza and in Jerusalem. We pray for the Middle East. We pray, God, in the mighty name of Jesus, let God arise and his enemies be scattered, God. Lord, that you would silence the mouth of the enemy, that you would silence his attacks, God, that you would undergird and put a hedge of protection around your people, God. Today, in this moment, Father, we say, have your way in this world, God. Have your way in this world, Father, in a moment like this. This is when the gospel shines brightest. God, would you help us share the good news like never before? Would you help us be a city on a hill, God, that announces that there is an answer to the calamity. There is an answer to the adversity. That answer is Jesus. God, today we plead the blood of Jesus over every situation. We plead the blood of Jesus over every situation. We plead the blood of Jesus over the nation of Israel. We plead the blood of Jesus over your persecuted church. We plead the blood of Jesus in every place in China, God, where your church is underground. We plead the blood of Jesus. And here's what we know, God. The gates of hell shall not prevail. And we stand in confidence and authority today that no weapon formed against us shall prosper, and every tongue that shall rise up shall be condemned. We stand in confidence today knowing that we are more than conquerors through Christ Jesus. We stand in confidence today knowing that victory is our portion, God. And we thank you, Lord. We pray for its protection. We pray for wisdom, God. We pray for peace to prevail in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we pray for peace to prevail in the mighty name of Jesus. And we submit this to you knowing that you are able to handle it. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And every heart say amen, amen, and amen. Come on, let's bless God one more time in the house. Come on, one more time. Bless God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. He is worthy to be praised. Man, thank you so much for worshiping and praying with us. You may be seated.
Wow, what a powerful start to our time together. We could almost just dismiss and go home now. But we ain't gonna do that. We good. Hey, we just want to welcome you guys here. If we haven't met, my name's Gary, part of our lead team here. Just so glad that you are here, all of you here in the room, those of you watching online, those of you catching us in one of our video venues right here on campus, just welcome. And hey, a special shout out if you're a guest here today. We're just so honored that you have spent part of your time, part of your weekend worshiping here with us. So thank you. And hey, we would love to connect with you. And the way we do that around here is through what we call a Connect card. So if you're here in the room, you've got a Connect card right there in your worship guide. If you're watching us online, you can click the Connect card link. And so that's really all we ask of you if you're a guest here today. Just complete that card. It's really short. It's just kind of your way to say hi. Just introduce yourself to us, and that'll allow us to introduce ourselves back to you. So please do that. And if you're here in the room, once you've completed the card, hang on to it. You can drop it off at one of our guest experience booths. There's one in the upper lobby, one in the lower lobby, because we've got a gift that we want to give you before you leave today. Just another way to say thank you for being here. Now, a couple of things going on around here. First, today's Men's Night. We're going to talk more about that in just a minute. But I want to let you know next Sunday, the 21st, is our next young adult gathering. And that happens right here on campus at 6:30. And this is our ministry to ages 18 to 30. And just a great time for worship, hangout, discussion, fun. And there's something really exciting happening within this group here in our church. So I just want to encourage you to be a part of that next Sunday. And then, listen, I can promise you every teenager knows it's about 6 weeks left of school at this point. And most parents do as well, which you're thinking about summer already. So I want to let you know about our summer camps for our students this summer. And listen, I can remember some of the most impactful moments in my life as a teenager in church happened at camp. I can still remember vividly. So I just want to encourage you, if you have a middle school or a high schooler, to register, to get them involved in a summer camp. This year, we've got a unique experience, two different camps, one for middle schoolers, one for high schoolers. So I just want to encourage you, get your kids in camp and let God do something in their life. You can scan the QR code. You can go to the student page on our website, find out all the information about summer camps happening this summer. And then finally, I just want to thank you for your giving, your generosity that allows us to do things like summer camps and everything that we do to invest in one more here to bring hope, to help people take a next step in Jesus. So just thank you for your giving. There's four ways that you can give around here. You can give in our lobbies through our giving stations and our giving kiosk. You can give through the Mountain West app. You can give online. You can set up a recurring gift that way, or you can text the number that you see, and it'll just take you to a link, and you can give whatever is easiest for you, wherever you are. You can give all of you watching online as well. However it works, however it's easy for you. When you give, one more lives, and that's just not some slogan. It really is an investment in the heart and soul of people, and that's what we're all about here, so thank you. All right. It's about time for the message today, so let's get ready. You can follow along in the notes right there in your worship guide, or you can click the note link online. So let's get ready to hear God's word today.
Morning, Mountain West. How you doing? Man, so good to see y'all. Glad that you're here. We're in week two of this series called Happy, and it's really a look at the Beatitudes and Jesus, finding joy Jesus's way. And before we get into that, I just want to encourage, if you are a man in here, tonight we are inviting you to our Men's Night, Authentic Manhood, and I just want to encourage you to be here. Doors open at 4:30. Okay, that was the first pitch. Ladies, if you are sitting next to your husband or you have a husband at home, please sign him up, and he will be better for it. He'll come home happy. He'll be relaxed. It's going to be a good week. All jokes aside, friends, this is going to be an event that you don't want to miss. I just encourage you to come out and check it out. We're really cultivating community amongst our men, challenging us to be who God has called us to be, to lead from the front and not from the sidelines anymore. Amen? All right, so one verse of scripture today, it is Matthew chapter 5, verse 4, and it says, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted." Would you pray with me? Father, thank you so much for the day that you have made, that we will rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you that you have given us a strategy for happiness your way. And I pray that you would open our eyes to see what you have to say to us. Give us ears to hear and hearts to receive what you would say. In Jesus' name, amen. So Facebook memories is a very interesting thing. It reminds you of stuff that you have forgotten about long ago. And today, 8 years ago, on April 14th, was a really sad day for me. My favorite basketball player, the greatest basketball player of all time, Kobe Bryant, he retired. It was his last game. And I remember vividly what I did. You know, I shed a tear. I crumpled up a piece of paper. I looked at a trash can, and I shot a basket, and I yelled out, Kobe. You know, it was just one of those iconic things. If you grew up in my age bracket and you were into sports, almost every time you were shooting a basket into a trash can, you yelled out Kobe's name. He was iconic. And the loss of his basketball playing years, even though he was not the same player that he used to be anymore, it hit me hard. And then fast forward to 2020, friends, and I knew it was going to be a bad year. Because Kobe died in a helicopter accident. And I mean, you would have thought this was my best friend. I couldn't get out of bed. I was sad. My friend, my best friend, he actually got me a newspaper from LA Times of what they did of Kobe. Grief and mourning, it just doesn't make sense sometimes. Have you ever been in a state of loss and you do stuff that just don't make sense to you? Go places that just doesn't make sense? You know, you're just having a regular day and you start crying out of nowhere. Grief has a way of hitting you in waves. Mourning is, it's not just this surface thing. It is a grief that hits you in your core. And Jesus says in his strategy for happiness is blessed are those who mourn. If that's not an oxymoron, I don't know what is. Happy are those who mourn? You mean, Jesus, if I cry, I'm going to be happy? If I'm sad, I'm going to be happy? If I'm discouraged, Jesus, make it make sense. I don't understand why mourning will help me be happy. Well, since you were asking the same question I'll ask, I want to show you in this text what Jesus actually means about mourning. And if you weren't here last week, I want you to understand that the whole premise of Matthew chapter 5 is really Jesus teaching his strategy about the kingdom. Jesus is unveiling his theology towards the children of Israel. He has brought them to this place. There are thousands there. He walks up to a mountain. He sits down and he begins to teach. And it is two chapters, 106 verses of teaching that Jesus unveils. And he says some things that are almost upside down. And I want to show you four truths about mourning that will actually help lead you to finding joy Jesus's way. Here's the first thing. Mourning helps you realize that it's okay not to be okay. You know, for so long, we have thought that we had to pretend that everything was going to be all right. Can I tell you, friends, that it's more exhausting to pretend that you're not okay than to just be honest about the fact that you're not okay? We live in a society that says that you've always got to be on. You've always got to be made up together. And I remember I went to speak at this other church, and I'm there, and they come in, and I'm in a green room, and they come in and say, do you want some makeup on? And I'm like, it's the first time this has ever happened to me. I was like, let me wait until my wife finished putting on the kids. I don't know what to do, how to handle this. But here was the premise behind that, is they wanted to cover all my flaws. And we do the same thing. We pat our faces. You know, I grew up in church where they would say, how you doing? Blessed and highly favored. Everything's going well. nothing could ever bother me. Can I tell you, friends, it is more exhausting to pretend to be okay than to actually admit I'm not okay. God doesn't stop being great just because you admit that your back aches. God is still great, and things may not be the way that you want them to be. It is okay to admit where things are broken and where things have gone wrong. Now, the primary premise of what Jesus is talking about is those who mourn their sin, who actually look at their sin and say, something's wrong with this. So something is not okay with me doing things that are contrary to God's will. Let me show you in the text. Luke 18 and 13. But the tax collector, standing afar off, would not even lift his eye to heaven, but beat his breast and saying, God, be merciful to me. I am a sinner. Here's what he is saying. He is saying, blessed are those who realize wrong is wrong. And I know we live in a world that likes to celebrate sin. But friends, we can never celebrate what God calls unholy and unrighteous. In a world that tells you to just chase your heart and your feelings, God tells us our heart is wicked and deceitful. If you follow your heart, you're going to end up in a ditch. He tells us not to follow our heart, but to trust in the Lord with all our heart. Not to follow your own mind, but to lean not on your own understanding and acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. You know, there was this TV show called Breaking Bad, and there's this guy on the TV show named Jesse. And Jesse is conflicted. He ends up murdering somebody, and he goes to an AA meeting and confesses about a half confession. He talks about how he murdered a dog. And do you know, in the TV show, they tried to tell him that it wasn't bad. It's okay. It's not a big deal. And you know, our world does that with sin today. It's not a big deal. It's okay. It's fine. There's nothing wrong with it. Friends, sin still separates you from God. And God is calling for our people not to celebrate and embrace sin, but to reject it and mourn it. That it's wrong. That we should not put ourselves in a situation. And even when we find ourselves in a situation, there should be mourning for sin. Here's what 2 Corinthians 7 and 10 says. For godly grief produces a repentance that leads to salvation without regret, whereas worldly grief produces death. Here's what worldly grief is. I'm sorry I got caught. I don't like the consequences of what I decided. Here's what godly grief is. I've sinned against you, O Lord. Forgive me. Restore unto me the joy of my salvation. The main premise of what Jesus is talking about is happy are those who realize wrong is wrong and are willing to admit it. But the larger implication of mourning is the fact that there is loss and it hurts. Mourning is a natural part of life, unfortunately, friends. And let me frame it like this. Everything that causes you to mourn is a result of sin. Everything. Every broken relationship is rooted in sin. Every time you weep before a casket, sin produced it. Every time you walk into a hospital room and you're wondering why someone has this disease or this calamity, it is the brokenness of sin that produced the brokenness of our world. And Jesus is saying, blessed are those who mourn this and understand the price of this. Ecclesiastic tells us that there is a time to mourn. And unfortunately, it is a part of life you can't avoid. I had someone tell me like this, tears are the price of loving someone deeply. So, the first part of this is Jesus helping us realize that there is freedom in admitting that I'm not okay. That there is an opportunity, a blessing in those who can acknowledge and have sorrow over what is wrong. Here's the second part of how mourning helps lead to Jesus's joy, is that mourning is a God-given opportunity for reflection. Here's what mourning does. I remember when my dad passed, and I just could not compute how people were still going to work. Did they not realize what has happened? You see, unfortunately, while you are mourning, the world is still spinning. And what mourning helps you to do, because you were in that rat race, you were in all of the continual spinning of the world, what mourning does is it forces you to pause and to consider what has happened. You know, I had a good friend. I don't know why some of my best friends are in their 60s. One named Greg, another one named Steve. Steve is 68. He just passed away a few weeks ago. But Steve Swanson, an incredible man. I remember I was very good. I'm third generation church of just saying what I'm supposed to say when people ask you the questions. How you doing? I'm great. Fantastic. And Steve paused. And he would not let me off with that kind of question. He said, no, how are you really doing? You know what mourning forces you to do? To ask the questions that you've been avoiding. Hey, here's what we have a tendency to do, is it's easier to keep going than to face the weight of the pain that we have experienced. But here's what Jesus is helping us to see. Those who mourn have taken the time to pause and to consider the effects of what's going on. Let me show you a great biblical example, friends. It's in Lamentations 3, verse 19. This is during the time where they are dealing with the most challenging situation. They have gone into exile, and it's just a field of tears, of just sorrow and difficulty. And here's what Jeremiah says, the weeping prophet. Remember my affliction and my wandering, the wormwood and the gall. My soul continually remembers it, and it's bowed down within me. But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercy never comes to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore I will hope in him. Here's the danger of unprocessed mourning and grief, is that it becomes a cancer that begins to eat away at you. It produces bitterness and gall. But if you are willing to deal with and sit with the pain of your own mistakes, the pain of what has happened in your world, wherever you find yourself mourning, if you're able to deal with it, here's the reality, friends, is that if you deal with it long enough, you'll be able to see God at the end of it. Here's what scripture says. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Here's what I'm trying to tell you, is that if you sit with it long enough, if you contemplate it long enough, you'll be able to see at the end of it, even through my tears, God is still good. Even through the difficulty and the pain, God is still good. You get to see on the other side of it that as I reflect, with pain in my chest, God is still good. With tears in my eyes, God is still good. And it doesn't mean what's happening to me feels good. One of the best ways God has been good to us is being present in our darkest moments. You know, David understood this all too well. He writes in Psalm 23, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death." You ever been in the valley? The shadow of death? You ever walked through some of the most difficult challenges? I remember when I was younger and my grandmother was going into surgery, and she had some physical challenges, and it did not look good. And she was walking through the valley. But in the midst of her walking, she was praying and singing songs to the Lord in the hospital room. I remember gathering around her bed and she talking about the goodness of God. I remember sitting around her bed and we sang that old school song, "What a Mighty God We Serve. What a Mighty God We Serve. Angels bow before him. Heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve." You see, there is something about God's presence in the valley that helps you endure the mourning of the moment. You don't get to experience that unless you pause and consider what's going on. Here's the third way that it produces joy, Jesus' way, friends. Mourning produces healthy lament. And if you're taking notes, please highlight that word lament. Lament has kind of been one of those things that has been written out of Christendom. We don't talk about lament anymore. You know what we like to talk about? And this is no shade if this is the people you listen to, but you know, it's your season, your best life, your next level. God is getting ready to get rid of your haters, and your haters gonna push the button on your elevator. We've got all those cute sayings and wonderful things. But can I tell you, lament is a part of what God has called us to? That healthy lament considers the error of our ways, some which is sin and some which is just, I made the wrong decision. He calls us to healthy lament. Can I show you what David? David is probably the best lamenter in scripture. Psalms 131 through 4. He says, "From the depths of despair, O Lord, I call for your help. Hear my cry, O Lord. Pay attention to my prayer. Lord, if you kept a record of our sins, who, O Lord, could ever survive? But you offer forgiveness that we might learn to fear you." Here's what true lament does, friends. True lament helps you stop making the same mistakes over and over again. Here's what true lament says, is that what I did was wrong and I'm not going back to it again. If I could frame it like this, true lament is an act of godly repentance. And I just said this earlier, but here's what godly repentance says. I was wrong and I offended God, and I'm not going to do it again. Here's what worldly repentance says. Dang, I got caught. If I say sorry, it'll be okay. If I say sorry, it might mitigate some of the punishment. You know, me and my wife, we watch this. We watch trash TV sometimes, but court TV, where they show you like what happens in the courtroom. And I can't tell you how many times this happens. A defendant pleads guilty and they get up there and say, "Your Honor, I don't know how I did this, and I'm so sorry to the." And as soon as they hear their sentence, they're like, "Yeah." They put on a show to hope that someone would show them leniency. Here's what I need you to understand, friends. God sees through the act, even if people don't. God sees through the act, even if you fooled other people. And godly repentance, you know, we have offered the world a cheapened grace. Here's what Jesus is actually calling for when he says, blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are those who realize what they were doing is wrong and turn and go in the opposite direction. Biblical repentance is not just admittance of wrong. It is a turning from that and going in the opposite direction. Saying, I can't go that way no more. I've got to go where God has called me to go. The truth is, friends, only godly repentance can save you. Repenting and believing on Jesus. And so, I know these kind of messages, you know, it's real quiet. The lights shout amen to me more than the people do. I know some of you are sitting there like, I thought y'all were hope-filled. Where are we going? So, Jesus encouraged us to mourn multiple times. And we've got this issue with lamenting. So how does it lead to joy Jesus' way? Here's what Jesus is saying, friends. That if you can admit where it's wrong, if you can admit where it hurts, if you can admit and be honest with it, you spend time considering it, and you actually lament it, here's what he says, you will be comforted. Here's the blessing. Here's where the joy comes in. It's not in the mourning. It's when who shows up in the midst of your mourning. Have you ever been around somebody who you could be sad all day long, and once they show up, they tell two jokes and you can't help but begin to laugh? Can I tell you about the God that you serve, that when he shows up in the nick of time, where he is, the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Where his Spirit is, the difficulty, the challenge, it may not change, but your perspective can't stay the same when God shows up. Here's what he is saying. Is that if you ever find yourself in a place of mourning, you can count on his comfort. What does that look like? Here's the fourth and final thing, friends. It's the promise of God's comfort. Here's what Jesus promises, that if you ever find yourself mourning, you will be comforted. If you ever find yourself wallowing in shame and regret, Spirit of the Lord will show up and lift your head. There's this meme going around a few years ago during the NCAA tournament. There was this young man who made an epic mistake, and he was walking with his head down. And one of his little teammates, he's about this big, one of his little teammates reached up and picked his head up. Say, you don't walk down like that. Can I tell you what God does for us? Is while you are wallowing in your mourning, Spirit of the Lord comes close and lifts your head up and says, I know you're in pain right now, but it's not going to end up like this. It's not going to be like this the whole time. And friends, I've been reading this all my life. And I've never seen it like this. Let me read Isaiah 61. 1 and 2 to you real quick. It says, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor, to comfort all who mourn. Here's why you'll be happy. It's because you get the promise of the Holy Spirit. And y'all, I told you, I've been reading this my whole life. I've never seen it like this before. The same word here for comfort, it is the same word Jesus uses in John 14, John 15, and John 16 for the Holy Spirit. It is this Greek word called paraclete. And listen, you don't have to speak Greek. That's fine. But if you don't know what a paraclete is, you may have heard of a paramedic. And here's what a paramedic does. A paramedic comes by you when you've been wounded in life and helps treat your wounds so that you don't die in the middle of it. They get you to the hospital so that you can recover from your injuries. Okay, you don't like the paramedic one. Fine. You don't like a paraclete. You don't like a paramedic. But you have heard of a parachute. And when you make the crazy decision to get up in a plane and jump out and you're falling in life, you can pull on the string of the parachute that will catch you before you fall. And here's what I need you to know. The Holy Spirit has a way of showing up. And right when you're getting ready to give up and throw in the towel, he will catch you before you fall. You want to know the good news? You know why you can be happy when you are mourning? It's because the Holy Spirit will show up in the nick of time and give you peace in the midst of your calamity, will give you joy in the midst of your mourning. He will exchange your spirit of heaviness for a garment of praise. This is the good news, that you got comfort from God's Spirit. And I don't know if you find yourself in the midst of mourning, but I just want to encourage you that the Holy Spirit is sending you joy. He is sending you his presence. And I want you to hear this. The comfort of the Holy Spirit is for your present sorrow, but it's also to lift your spirits with the hope of tomorrow. It is for your present situation, but Scripture describes him as the seal of the promise of God. You want to know what that promise is? Can I read it to you? It is in Revelation 21, 4 and 5. There are some of you who walked in with tears today. Let me give you the promise comfort of the Holy Spirit. He will wipe away every tear from their eye, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. And he who was seated on the throne said, "Behold, I am making all things new." He said, "Write these down, for these words are trustworthy and true." You see, you can have hope and joy for tomorrow in the middle of mourning, because God's presence is near. He has sent the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, to help you in your moment of need. Now, I want to close with this story. There, you know, I like to read history and learn about stories. And there was this man in Chicago, had his family, and they were well off, they had a good life, and things were great. And unfortunately, friends, he found himself in a very precarious position. The fires of Chicago showed up and burned away most of his real estate holdings. But he still had, you know, some resources, and he said, "Our family, we need a start over. We need a vacation, a refresher." So they said, "We're gonna take a trip to Europe." And right before they were going to get on the boat, he got called back to finish a business deal. And he said, "You guys go ahead and I'll catch up with you in a week." Well, while that boat was headed over to Europe, they crashed into another boat. And that boat sank within 12 minutes. And his daughter, his wife and four daughters were on the boat. And all four of his children died. And only his wife was saved. And so, in the midst of overwhelming grief, he gets on a boat to go meet his wife, who made it to Europe. And he gets to the place where his daughters drowned. And in a cacophony of agony, he begins to write words to songs that makes no sense. He writes these words: "When peace like a river attendeth to my soul." And here's what I want you to hear. I want you to hear the words of this song under the backdrop of what he wrote, because here's the reality, friends. He understood something that we need to learn, that no matter my station in life, as long as I have Jesus, it is well with my soul. Everything else could lose, everything else can go wrong, but as long as I have Jesus, it is well. Would you listen to this song? One question for you. Is it well with your soul? Is it well with your soul? Today, Jesus offers you an opportunity for life. If you know you need that, in a moment we're going to pray and then we're going to dismiss. But if you know you need to make it right with Jesus, here's what I'm going to ask you to do. I'm going to pray a prayer, and I want you to pray that prayer with me, and then mark that on your card, on the Connect card that you got, and come meet me down front or go to our guest experience booth so that we can help you take your next step. Today, it can be well with your soul. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you. We bless you again for what you have done in this moment. Thank you for reminding us, God, that even though we mourn, we can be comforted by you. That the joy is in your presence, God, not in the happenings, but in you being near and close to us. And today, God, we affirm that it is well with our soul. God, for the person that needs that to become true in their life today, for the person that needs to surrender to you, I pray today would be their day. And if that's you, I want you to pray this simple prayer with me. Lord Jesus, save me. Change me. Make me into the person that you want me to be. Forgive me of my sins. I receive your salvation today. And today I thank you for making it well with my soul. Father, I pray for your people. Lift every burden, God. Destroy every yoke, God. Let your people walk in freedom and confidence today. That even though mourning has lasted for a night, there is a joy coming in the morning. That you're wiping away the tears, God. You're turning things around, God. For your glory and for our good, we give you thanks and praise. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. In every heart say amen. Amen and amen. Come on, one more time. Put your hands together for Jesus. Hey, we're going to end like we always end with saying this blessing over us, Romans 15 and 13. May the God of all hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. God bless you. See you guys tonight, man, and see you next week.
got a story too good to hide. I was a blind man wandering until I saw the light. Yeah, I got a story I can't deny. I'm a living, breathing miracle, and I just gotta testify.